Much for coming back so promptly, and we're going to set the stage now for a look at the content of this most important report here on achieving food security in the face of climate change, which has been produced by the Commission on Sustainable Agriculture and Climate Change. We have one of its commissioners with us here on a video link. Marion, are you receiving? Do you hear? Are you? Okay. Marianne, bonjour, bonsoir. Hello. Okay. Okay, very good. Now I hear you. I was saying that we're okay. We are beginning our afternoon session now on the content of this very excellent report that has been issued by the Commission. We here in Sweden have already been looking at the policy summary in November, and using this information and your seven recommendations in training courses we organized together with FAO in December. So even though the final report didn't appear until March, we're well aware of the work that you've been doing on this excellent report. And I would like to then give the word to Marion Guillou, who is president of the Institute for Scientific Agricultural Research in France. The word is yours. Please present. Very well, very clearly.
Okay, so hello to all the participants to the conference. So it's my pleasure to present you our report. In fact, I was a member of this International Commission on Agriculture and Climate Change, and maybe if you have got now my slides.
Yes,
Have you got them?
we do.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So, my point was to show you our conclusions, and on each conclusions or a few of the conclusions, not to be too long, to show what could be the role of global donors in what will happen. So first, to start with some facts, in fact. Our planet today has sufficient food for all the people that live on it, but at the same time, you have 1 billion people that go hungry and 1.5 billion overweight. Of course, all of you know about that, but it's always useful to remember that the situation is quite paradoxical. It is estimated at the same time that a third of food produced for human consumption is lost or wasted across the global food system. And in fact, today, if we may say that in one sentence, food insecurity afflicts communities throughout the world, but mainly because of inequalities and poverty that prevent assured access to food supplies. So, of course, when we look at the coming years with an increased population, with food prices that will maybe rise further and become more volatile, with extreme weather events such as high temperature, drought, and floods that will be more frequent, well, we need to be very conscious that we have to think together about the situation and about what we should do. So my next slide is about the commission. So who are the people that did that work and got the conclusions that you have worked about? So we come from all the major regions of the world. There is a wide range of scientific backgrounds in agriculture, in climate, in ecology, in economics, in trade and nutrition. We acted as independent people in our personal capacity. We did not represent our institutions. And our mandate was quite clear. It was to articulate scientific findings on the potential impact of climate change on agriculture and food security globally and regionally. And it was, of course, to try to identify the most appropriate action to achieve food security in the context of climate change for the coming years. So in the next slide, it's almost impossible to read, but
it is to explain to you how we have worked. In fact, the report represents the expert opinion of 13 commissioners. But in fact, we worked on the basis of our experience, informed by the findings of 16 recent and authoritative assessments of climate change and food security. And we, in fact, did some special studies on two topics, food price volatility and eating patterns. And then the report was developed with discussions, well, physical or video discussions over a period of 12 months with iterative review by the commissioners and a final external review. So, in fact, it is always very difficult to pretend to understand and to give advice on such a big topic, but we tried to be there to inform global policy processes. So we issued several recommendations. So on the next slide. Yes, you have the list of the four first recommendations. In fact, our collective choice, which is our opinion, related to agriculture and food system must be revisited. Sustainable agriculture and greater efficiency in the food system is a critical part of the response. So, as you will see, our recommendations are there with very concrete and urgent actions that are suggested to be implemented by a constellation of actors, governments, international institutions, investors, agricultural producers, consumers, food companies, researchers, and donors, of course. And on the next slide, you have the three other recommendations. So the next slide, please. Yes, so you see that there are quite ambitious recommendations. So I will come back to some of them to underline the role global donors could have to help their realization. If I come back to recommendation one, the next slide. In fact, it suggests to establish a work program on mitigation and adaptation in agriculture in accordance with the principles of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. And our target is to have a first step with inclusion of agriculture in the mainstream of international climate change policy. Then the second target is to make sustainable and climate-friendly agriculture central to green growth and the Rio Plus 20 Earth Summit that is coming soon. Then we underline the need to finance early action to drive change in agricultural production systems towards increasing resilience to weather variability and shocks, while contributing as soon as possible and significantly to mitigating climate change. This includes supporting national climate risk assessment, developing mitigation and adaptation strategies, and program implementation. We suggest to develop common platforms at all levels, global, regional, national levels, for coherent dialogue and policy action related to climate change, agriculture, crisis response, and food security. This includes fostering country levels, coalitions for food security and building resilience, and particularly in countries most vulnerable to climate shocks. So to give examples, to implement this recommendation, global donors could encourage investment in integrated agricultural adaptation and mitigation, help such country-level coalitions to be put in place, especially in countries most vulnerable. And some examples are already in place, for instance, with the Green Climate Fund, with 100 billion per year by 2020 for mitigation and adaptation in developing countries, least developed country funds, adaptation fund, nationally appropriate mitigation actions, and so on, or I could quote the global environment facilities or the official development assistance. So it's to say that some actions are already in place, but much more has to be done. If I try to go to the second recommendation, it's the next slide. In fact, this recommendation is about implementing and strengthening the existing G8 L'Aquila program and commitments, including long-term commitments for financial and technical assistance. It's to enable UNFCCC to prioritize sustainable agriculture program. It's to adjust national research and development budget and to build integrated scientific capacity. For example, developing nutritious non-grain crops and reducing post-harvest losses. It's to increase knowledge of best practices and access to innovation. North, south, 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 or cross-commodity or farmer-to-farmer exchanges, or action directed to women farmers. The global donors should use L'Aquila as a cornerstone for increasing investment to boost sustainable agricultural practices and to organize financing around nationally owned frameworks. There again, there are already some actions in place, as the commitment of $20 billion over 3 years for agricultural development in impoverished countries. That was the initiative of L'Aquila, of course. Or the Global Agriculture and Food Security Program. So here again, some actions have started, and I would like to take the example of Kenya on the next slide, please. So in fact, it's very interesting local action that has been quite efficient to improve smallholders' market access and production efficiency. The target was to help East Africa Dairy Development Project with Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda actions. And several partners are involved in that action, with International Livestock Research Institute, the World Agroforestry Center, HIFER International, TechnoServe, or Nestle, and it has been funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And in fact, it boosted the incomes of millions of smallholders in East Anglia just with actions on improved breeding technologies, animal nutrition practices, and a better access to the market. If I go to our recommendation 4, it's to target some populations that are most vulnerable to climate changes and food insecurity. Of course, to develop funds to provide rapid relief when there are extreme events, to moderate food price fluctuations by sharing country information and production forecasts, to know about the stocks, to create and support safety nets and other programs to help vulnerable populations, to establish emergency food reserves, or to support platforms to integrate all the data and to coordinate the global donor programs and policies. And here again, the donors should design large-scale programs to increase incomes and market access for poor producers, or to encourage local participatory programs that respond to the needs of poor rural population. So it's necessary to create and support those platforms that should systematically integrate climate change risk management, adaptation and mitigation co-benefits, and improved local nutritional outcomes. And here again, there are already some good examples. GDPRD, CGR Fund Council, that have platforms already in construction. A practical example is on the next slide with the program that involves the Ethiopian government and a program that is called the Productive Safety Net Program. It takes a development-oriented approach to food aid that creates an assured governmental safety net and so a greater predictability for smallholders. It combines international donor funding, it's over 1.27 billion US dollars over the last 6 years, and the government supplies infrastructure, labor, and inputs that are evaluated 500,000 US dollars. And in fact, it looks at the workers, whether they are able-bodied adults, then they receive transfers of cash and food for their participation in labor-intensive public works, while other households receive unconditional transfers. And the public works initiative improve soil quality, water supply, ecological condition, infrastructure, and social services. And so now it is in its third phase and operational in 317 administrative districts, and it is reaching 7.7 million beneficiaries. Complementary programs address household asset building, community infrastructure development, and the World Food Program and other partners have developed a stream of technical advice and a stakeholder platform that provides oversight. So that's a good example of a very practical and successful common initiative. If I look at recommendation 5, it's the next slide. There we suggest to reshape food access and consumption patterns to ensure the basic nutritional needs and to foster healthy and sustainable eating habits worldwide. In fact, now everybody knows that we have to address at the same time undernutrition and hunger and overnutrition around all the regions of the world. So we have to promote positive changes in the variety and quantity of diets through innovative education campaigns, through economic incentives that align the marketing practices of retailers and processors with public health and environmental goals. We could as well promote and support a set of evidence-based sustainability metrics and standards to monitor and evaluate food security, nutrition, and health practices and technologies across supply chain, agricultural productivity efficiency, resource use and environmental impacts, and food system cost and benefits. And this could include, for instance, providing consumers with clear labeling. If I try to show you on the next slide, the evolution of the world diet, I mean, each set of dots, I mean, a green, a red, and a blue, is linked with one country. So there you see the diet composition for 178 countries during that time lag. And it's 2005 to 2007. And in fact, you see that the tendency is the same everywhere. That is to say that when the country develop, in fact, the consumption of cereals and vegetables decreases, while the consumption of sugar, of fats, and animal products increases. So this transition has happened in developed countries over a century, and a similar but greatly accelerated pattern can be seen in Asia, Central and Latin America, and to a lesser extent in Africa, where these same diet transitions are occurring within 20 years in emerging countries and within 40 years in developing countries. And so there again, and it's at the next slide, global donors can contribute to funding specific programs. And there I take the example of a program, a very practical and useful program, that has been put in place by WHO and FAO. So first, they worked on such initiatives to increase both production and consumption of fruits and vegetables. So the first program was put in place in Southeast Asia, then in Portuguese-speaking countries, and in 2007, it was put in place in 18 French-speaking countries that are now involved through Africa. And so again, that's a very practical example of what could be done very efficiently. If I come to recommendation six, it is the recommendation to reduce loss and waste in food systems. Of course, because improving harvest and post-harvest management, food storage and transport can make a big difference. Integrating policies and programs that can reduce waste in food supply chains, economic innovation to enable low-income producers to store food during period of excess supply, and to create obligations for distributors to separate and reduce food waste. To reduce waste, you have to create incentives to help people to know how to redirect food waste to other purposes. And again, governments and global donors could develop local, relevant, integrated models for reducing food loss and waste, direct financing towards infrastructures improvements, as roads, energy sources, markets, infrastructure for storage, for packing, for transport, and all those investments can provide the foundation for subsequent private sector investments. The donors can build capacity for post-harvest loss reduction, including knowledge of handling practices, safety standards, access to tools and supplies, information about costs and benefits. There could be training and extension programs with follow-ups, and in middle and high-income countries, a use of a mix of public campaigns, advertising, taxes, regulation, guidelines, improved labeling can help reduce consumer and food service sector waste. If I try to show you in the next slides, where are the losses and waste? You see on the left, I hope, the consumption and pre-consumption stages and the losses in different regions. The consumption is red and the producing to retailing losses are green. And on the right, you see the part of initial cereal production that is lost or wasted at different stages of the food supply chain in different regions of the world. Of course, it doesn't take into account the transformation factor linked to animal feed. But you see that depending on the region of the world, the places where the losses and waste occur are very different. So there again, and it's the next slide, the global donors can work with government or can take initiatives that are very efficient. And we took the example of what has been done in the United Kingdom, where approximately 22% of household food and drink is wasted at the moment. So they have acted. Yes.
Yes, we need to have time for discussion after this. So I would ask you to
okay,
try.
So I will go.
I don't want to miss okay. Recommendation number seven, though.
Yes, you will miss a few of them. So I suggest to go to the next slide then.
Okay.
So the role of the global donors, of course, we could give a lot of examples, but time is missing, so I won't do that. And I just go to the next slide to thank you for your attention. and to open the discussion.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. No one ever listens to me and reacts that rapidly in my experience. I appreciate very much. I'm sure we do have a number of questions here, and I'd like to open it up to the audience here to have your questions now that you have a direct possibility. I would also like to mention that there are so many people on the live streaming of this that some people are having difficulty watching you. We had our technicians are working very hard to accommodate more than the 300 that are already watching, and there are quite a few. So those of you who can hear me but not see anything, please be patient. We're trying to get you onto our live streaming. And I congratulate you, Dr. Guillou, that you are so popular that you overload our systems.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're
it's
welcome.
Because I've been quick.
Ah, yes. It must be. Okay, please, reactions from the floor, questions. No? Yes.
Hi. We've had a couple of tweets going on online, and one thing that's been retweeted a couple of times was one of the quotes from you, Marion, which was, inequalities is at the root of food security. So I was wondering if you could expand a little bit more on that, please.
Yes, of course. And I'm sure that you share that opinion, that today, in theory, you have the quantity of food that is necessary on our planet for all the inhabitants. But of course, the situation is very different from a situation of satisfaction. On average, we have 3,000 kilocalories per person per day that is available. But in fact, when you look at the OECD average or the South Sub-Africa average, it's very different. So the first cause is the problem of access. And Amartya Sen described that quite well, in fact. And of course, you have the political troubles, the war trouble, that have to be taken into account. And at the same time, the economic access. And what is very interesting is there, agriculture, in a way, is a double solution. Because most of the people that suffer from hunger are poor farmers or poor people without land. And if you improve the production of agriculture, then they can go out from hunger. And at the same time, it restarts the development of the rural zone, and it helps the situation quite widely around them. So in fact, today, I think our common target is to fight inequalities and to fight poverty.
Thank you very much. I'm sure there are not many in this room who would disagree with that. Yeah, okay, we have another question, please.
Is this working? Yeah. My name is Hanna Wetterstrand. I'm working for the Swedish Cooperative Center as well, as a former person who asked the question. I'm especially interested in the question related to price volatility in food, and whether you could collect the recommendations that came from your report. I heard you saying that raising the importance of countries sharing information about the prospects of harvest, etc. But as far as I know, it's often very difficult to know or to predict, and it's also related to a lot of other factors like oil prices, etc. So I'm wondering if you had any more recommendations that you could highlight on that, because I think that's a very serious and problematic issue. I'm thinking of, for instance, the increased speculation in food, etc., and the involvement of the financial sector in that.
Yes. Yes, it is a very interesting question, because in fact, you remember that a few years ago, let's say 2 years ago, even 2 years ago, volatility was looked at as a necessity of the market. That is to say, it was a way to adapt the offer and the demand of food in a way. But now we have an abnormal volatility, let's say. So you will see that we will publish a scientific article, because we did a special job on that topic, a special work, to try to understand the new sources of volatility. And of course, you have quoted a few of those new sources. That is to say, well, the fact that you have new actors on the market, on the financial market, involving agricultural commodities, the link that can be done now between energy prices market and the agricultural commodities market, and a very nervous and stresses reaction of the financial markets, even when it is linked to commodity prices. And so so that is about the diagnosis, of course, and you will see that we have written an article that will underline the diagnosis more precisely. And then which solutions could we recommend? And maybe you noticed in 2008 that even when the international market was no more in crisis, in 32 countries, the prices remained high for quite a long time. And of course it was possible because there was no information that the crisis was over. And of course those 32 countries were mainly very poor countries. And so we are convinced that information is a very efficient tool to fight speculation, abnormal speculation. So that's why we recommend an information tool on the situation of the market, on the situation of the stocks. And as you know, on the G20 meeting last year, some countries agreed about that, but for some countries, they thought it was too strategic information to give it and to share it. So it will need time to convince all the countries that this information is needed. But we think it's very important that this information is given to everybody so that there is no artificial panic on the market. And of course, prediction of the harvest is quite important so that you can see that the situation, even if you have a crisis somewhere in the world, that it will be sufficient altogether. And there we have tools of prediction that are in place more and more, linked to satellite images most of the time. And it will be again a tool against abnormal speculation. So yes, we have suggested a diagnosis and some recommendations to fight against it. And rules of the financial markets belong to those recommendations.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for one more question. I would like to say that all of those who are presenting via video and our own respondents here will be available online for perhaps a group discussion towards the end. So this isn't your absolute last chance to ask, but I think we have one more question from the floor.
My name is Gunnel Axelsson, the Candor Church of Sweden. And the name of the commission itself, and it is sustainable agriculture. And you're also talking about sustainable intensification in terms of increasing production. Now, of course, sustainable is a word that is used and defined in many different ways. And I noticed that in recommendation three, you're talking about multi-benefit farming, about minimizing ecosystem degradation and community design programs, which I would say, coming in from the NGO side, would be elements of what we often talk about as agroecological approaches, where you put an emphasis on optimized use of local resources before turning to external input. My question now is how the Commission has been approaching the definition of sustainable agriculture.
You're right. I mean, we all talk about sustainability, but we need, every time we talk about that, first to spend some time being sure that we have the same conception of sustainability. So we suppose that sustainability is to provide the quantity while being very careful about the environmental and social and economic conditions of this production. And so we took some examples, maybe to be more clear. Our sustainability so has several components, and we gave the example of the soil actions, for instance. That is to say, if you have a lively soil, then it prevents erosion, and at the same time, it gives more production. We took the example of the agroforestry experiments. We took several examples like that. When you try at the same time to increase the global production and to be very careful about the sustainability of the biodiversity, water, air quality, and soil quality. So we tried to take it into its more complete conception.
Thank you very much.
It answers your question.
I think it does. Or we will ask you further questions later on. Thank you very much for your input. Obviously, this is an area that you are extremely interested in, both intellectually and as a human being, and you're very good at your subject. Thank you very much. The rest of the program builds on responses to this report, and one of them will be presented here in situ by the Associate Professor of Human Geography from the University of Lund, Agnes Andersson Jurfeld. She is a member of the Siani Network, and we are happy to have her here today to discuss her long-running research since 2001, I think, in smallholder productivity in agriculture and how she thinks food security can be achieved in sub-Saharan Africa. Agnes.
I was supposed to wave to someone. Oh, I waved to get the sound. Thank you. I'm very delighted to be here, and I was very interested to hear Marion Guillot's presentation of the recommendations. I think to start off with, I'll say that I think one of the very positive things about the recommendations is that they put the smallholders in focus, and I think that's a welcome change from earlier policies. I should also start out by saying that I'm here as a researcher, so I'll be presenting my reactions to the report and the Commission's recommendations on the basis of my research and the research that I've been carrying out. So I'm not representing civil society or the donors and so on. As Melinda said, I'm Agnes Andersson Jurfeld. I come from Lund University from the Department of Human Geography. And I work on basically food security among smallholders in 9 different African countries using a mixed methods approach, combining qualitative and quantitative methods. I have a strong interest not only in food security, but also in gender issues tied to smallholder agriculture in sub-Saharan Africa. And I'll pick up on Gunnel's point about the whole concept of sustainability. And I think we can talk in one respect of ethical sustainability when it comes to food security and food insecurity. It's a deeply ethical issue in terms of how to fight hunger, starvation, and malnutrition. And it needs to be part of the sustainability concept, I think. So I think before we start considering the hows, which is very much what this report is about, or the recommendations, we need to consider the whys. Why are we doing this? Why are we interested? And to start off with, I'd start by arguing that it's an ethical issue in the sense that this deep set inequality that characterizes the global food system today that Marion outlined, so I won't say more about that. It's also an economic and ethical issue in the sense that how to encourage growth that reduces poverty. So not only how do we fight food how do we accomplish food security, but how do we encourage growth that has positive effects on poverty reduction? And there's a big body of research that looks on the links between agriculture and its poverty reducing effects. So I'll just mention that. But in the context of Africa, it's also a political and deeply practical issue, which perhaps we tend to forget about sometimes. And that's how to feed growing cities when the countryside cannot feed itself as it is today. Now, Africa's urban areas today comprise about 37% of the population, or they hold about around between 35 and 40% of the population in sub-Saharan Africa. By 2050, they're projected to hold about 57%. I checked the UN population prospects yesterday. So it's a practical issue in a whole set of ways. And the other practical issue arises from the era of cheap food imports being believed, most commentators is believed to be over. So we have a situation of where cities and urban areas, basically non-agrarian pursuits, are growing quite rapidly, but the option of feeding growing urban populations through cheap food imports is shifting also. And this means that there is this practical impetus to solving these issues also. So as I said, rural Africa contains about 65% of Africa's population. And in some respects, also from the pragmatic point of view, these are the people who should be in focus. Most of them earn a living as smallholder farmers, growing mainly food crops, grains, tuber staples, mostly for subsistence. And there's a strong overlap between poverty and rurality in the sense that most of Africa's poor live in the rural areas. As part of the food price crisis of 2008, there was, of course, urban food riots and so on, and there was a rise in urban poverty also. So we cannot forget about that part, but nonetheless, there is a strong overlap. Livelihoods in the rural areas are mainly agriculture-based, and they are agriculture-based, but production is largely disconnected from global food systems in the sense that they're not selling to a world market. There's a lot of discussion about how to engage smallholder farmers with global markets. But for most African food producers or smallholder food producers, the global market is very distant in terms of their own marketing strategies, meeting the global market. However, since many tend to be net consumers of food rather than net producers, that is, they need to buy some of their food requirements, they're connected indirectly as consumers to the global world market. So that means they're susceptible to import prices, especially of food staples. And in this sense, there are two key ways of improving food security in rural areas. One is to enable smallholder producers to produce more food to be able to feed themselves and their families. And the other is to encourage production for the market and hence raise incomes. Of course, you can do both. But the opportunities for doing both at the same time tend to vary a lot. Between different parts of Africa, between different types of areas, between peri-urban areas connected to urban markets and areas in more marginal parts of countries, villages. So this is the starting point, and I'll be saying something about this on the basis of a project which I head, which is called the Afrint Project. We've had two rounds of data collection in this, and we're setting out for the third round of data collection in a smaller number of countries than originally intended. But in 2002, the main research question was to look at the challenges of staple crop intensification. And staple crops are mainly roots and tubers and the grain crops, which will be what Africa needs to produce more of to be able to feed the growing cities and the growing rural population. And this was a comparative project that aimed to situate the possibilities for intensifying agriculture, especially in the food crop sector, compared with Asia. And then in 2008, we carried up a follow-up on round one to gauge changes in the staple crop sector, what had happened, basically. And this project covers 9 countries, so Ethiopia, Kenya, Uganda, Mozambique, Zambia, Tanzania, Nigeria, Ghana, and I'm missing one, Malawi. And it's based in 20 different regions and around 100 villages. And there are 4,000 farm households that have been interviewed through a questionnaire. 3,000 are still in the panel, so they've been interviewed in both 2002 and 2008. And importantly, the farm households are located where the majority of people in Africa live, basically. So they capture sort of the smallholder realities quite well. And then, so what is the problem? As I said, at one level, it's a pragmatic problem. How to feed a population that's basically shifting out of agriculture into other pursuits. And at one level, this problem is quite basic. Here is a list of yield gaps in the villages in question. And basically, the mean yields, as you'll see, they're very low by global standards. They're extremely low. And this shows, this is a cross-section, so it's not the panel households. So in that sense, it's statistically representative for the villages. But you'll see that for maize, the mean yield has actually dropped from 2002 to 2008. And the potential yield, or what we've become interested in, is we can't see the yield gap. We can only see it on my screen. Is there any way of, or you can see it over there, but not here? I think I've been in this situation at CEDA before, actually, but we could see half the screen. Well, anyway, as you'll see, this measures the difference between the 10% highest producers in the village, their average production or average yield, compared to the rest. So as you'll see, the yield potential is quite large, and it looks at, it sort of controls for village-specific characteristics. And that's what makes it interesting as a measure of what could be accomplished. And you'll see that for some crops like sorghum, the yield gap has actually widened. For most of them, it's sort of stayed the same, more or less. It's quite stable. But at one level, this is the problem. That such a large proportion of smallholders are actually producing below their capabilities, or below what is actually possible in these places. And then one might ask, then, why? Why is this occurring? So one explanation can be found in the production dynamics, with decreasing farm sizes being one example, especially in populous countries, or in countries with fairly fast-growing populations, with a lack of very highly productive land like Kenya. There's also a very low use of fertilizer, low use of improved seed technology, uneven access to land, and gender-based discrimination generally in access to productive resources. And that's not only technological resources, but also things like labor, which tends to be underestimated, I think, in many discussions, and seasonal aspects of access to labor. So if we look at then the soil problem, or the nutrient problem, soils are severely depleted, especially in densely populated areas. And this is a map of, and I'm not a soil expert, so but it's an illustration of annual nutrient depletion occurring, especially in densely populated areas. I mentioned Kenya earlier, Tanzania and Ethiopia are also here. And at the same time, sub-Saharan Africa in global terms is an extremely small user of fertilizer, while unequal access to fertilizer is projected to continue at the global level. Something happened. So here we see developed countries, and this is a map from IFPRI that compares sub-Saharan Africa to the rest of the world, basically. And so at one level, the lack of inputs is a very real problem in many parts of rural Africa. And this is, of course, related to expenditures, but also to sheer availability and timing. So Malawi has become famous for its fertilizer subsidy program, but at the same time, there are severe problems with timing issues and seasonality in relation to accessing fertilizers. So there are lots of different aspects to this fertilizer dilemma. But there are also market-related explanations for this. So if we look at these households, approximately half of the staple crop producers sell something. And whereas the share of non-commercialized farmers, that is farmers that don't actually sell anything, has actually increased between 2002 and 2008. And more maize is, but less sorghum is being sold if we look at the average amounts marketed among those households that do sell. But basically, staple crop amounts sold remain very low. 5 minutes. Oof. And then we have, perhaps I should skip this and go on to the but it will explain what I have to say. But basically, the situation is connected to the smallholder producer consumer. So smallholders are both producers and consumers, most of them. Expensive inputs and low producer prices makes life difficult. And they have livelihoods that are prone to seasonality and extreme weather events, but also to markets and shifts in markets. So hedging bets outside agriculture to avoid seasonal shifts through dispersing labor becomes a strategy of getting by, basically, which means that division of labor over time and space is crucial. And this has also resulted in the development of multispatial consumption systems where you have urban households being fed by rural relatives. So the smallholders are having their food security stretched in lots of different ways, which also have to do with demography. And this has resulted or results often in a vicious cycle of poor producer and consumer confidence in the market as a provider of food, both in urban and rural areas. And then I'll just skip this. I'll skip this and I'll get to this revisiting the 7 recommendations from the Commission. And this is just a mental note, so I won't actually talk about them in detail. But I'll say something, and I think many of the points have already been raised by the audience. But I think one aspect, and I'd like to stress, I think this smallholder emphasis is a very good thing in this report. But one aspect that I think is missing is this connection to non-food systems. So basically, policies and strategies have different consequences in different places. And that the effects of reducing greenhouse gas emissions in the developed world may indirectly affect food security in developing countries. I think this whole issue of discussing inequalities in the global food system could have been applied also to other types of inequalities outside the global food system. And in that sense, links between developing and developed countries may actually lie outside the food system and still affect the food security in the developing world. And one example is the energy food nexus and how the competition over coarse grains as feedstocks for biofuels on the one hand, animal feed on the other hand, and finally as human food, have very strong effects and interplay with one another and affect farmers and smallholders and also the urban poor. And I don't think I couldn't find it in the report. I read the final report also. And then countries are tied together both directly and indirectly through trade links, for instance. This issue was raised earlier. Also what I couldn't find was this reference to large-scale land acquisitions that Brian raised earlier, and where you could potentially have a situation of pitching the food security of the poor against food security of the non-poor, and I'm also missing that discussion of how is that to be handled. So I think that issues of global governance that could have been specified is, on the one hand, how to redress institutional inequalities in the global system, agricultural trade on the one hand, given the emergence of the BRICS as major players in global food markets, and also in developing countries in themselves. We find Brazil entering the markets, for instance, in West and Southern Africa with these effects indirect effects, at least, of dumping food prices. And how do we handle that? And how does that affect food security among these countries? Then another issue that I looked for in vain, I think, or there are a few references, is how to manage processes of private sector food retailing expansion and the whole process of supermarketization. Not so much supermarketization here, which is also an issue, and how standards and private sector standards potentially lock smallholders out of markets in European countries or in the US, but also how is supermarketization in staple crops, in grain crops, in developing countries affecting smallholders as producers of food and also consumers? Because there is this side of the supermarketization process in Kenya or Tanzania, Uganda, where South African supermarkets are entering the markets quite strongly for maize, especially. And then how to ensure that climate policy, especially in relation to energy in the developed world, does not jeopardize food security in the developing world. So not so much taking climate change as a given, but how to handle it in practice on the ground. But how does the developed world come up with a responsible climate policy in the sense of not jeopardizing or making sort of food insecurity worse? Because here it's assumed that climate change itself will do that, which I think is fair enough, but there are also policies of dealing with climate change that may affect smallholder realities. And then I think returning again to the issue of civil society and how to engage regional and global initiatives outside the donor sector specifically. So for instance, AGRA or the Gates Foundation, farmers organizations, and sort of the strategies for doing that. And perhaps that's the next step. It's sort of what will come after the recommendations. And then I think just summing up here with consequences for smallholders in sub-Saharan Africa of the proposed recommendations. I think consequences very greatly dependent on how they're operationalized. And I'll return to this issue of recommendation 3 and the whole agroecological, because I agree with you, it has that slant towards agroecology. And I think one example is recommendation 3. How will that be operationalized? Now, that will have consequences, for instance, in terms of complexities of labor use. If you shift towards very labor-intensive strategies of agricultural production, that shift or that increase in labor intensity for the household as a whole will tend to fall on women within the households and add to already labor-intense lives, basically. And I think that's something that needs to be dealt with. How do we ensure that this does not actually pose undue labor demands and affect the seasonal aspects of already vulnerable livelihoods? Also, I think the links to the non-farm sector, again, especially among women who have smaller opportunities in agriculture, need to be considered. How are they to be dealt with? I would also say that many of the recommendations, in one sense, have a one-size-fits-all point of departure. And in one way, I guess that's natural if you have recommendations of this character. But the references to technology, I think, are one example of refrigeration technology, for instance, where in many areas refrigeration is just out of the question. I mean, I think the emphasis in many areas need to be on extremely low tech level. Then the issue of community-based initiatives tend to have their own problems, and this has been tried and tried and tried in decentralization agendas of different kinds tied to different types of political decentralization that again tend to be need to be critically assessed before they're sort of launched, because they carry their own problems of internal democracy and so on, and also of again gender roles, political and equity problems. And I think that the potential politicization of some of the initiatives that are mentioned need to be carefully dealt with. Ethiopia was mentioned earlier, but Ethiopia has quite a few political problems also. Fertilizer subsidies are mentioned, and I think that's, I mean, it's, again, it's fair enough to, and I think that's, it's a good thing that fertilizer is being recognized as something that's necessary, but they do carry issues of politics also that are sometimes are not present really in the. I don't think I went past 5 minutes.
It was fascinating. It doesn't matter. Okay, are you winding up? Very good. Thank you very much. Stay. Don't go anywhere.
Okay.
I'm sure that we'll have some comments on your. Excellent discussion. I know your research already, so I won't comment on that. I thought it was just one sort of overarching question I'd like to ask you before I open it up. And then when you looked at these, the different things that were missing and the negative small things like global governance, land grabbing, food versus fuel, and the negative consequences for smallholder agriculture, I wonder how you look at these recommendations as a whole. Do you think they're useful? Do they move things forward? Or do you think it's just another list of wish list from international?
I think they're trying to do everything at one time. I mean, in that sense, they're not dealing with the difficult question. Mm-hmm. So, and I think that's they're not. I mean, I think the difficult questions are sort of the institutional inequalities in the different types of global systems. I think what they do, which is good, is deal with the consumption production aspect of the food system, but they're not dealing with world trade essentially. I mean, there's a few references to trade. They're not dealing with energy versus food, and so so I think that would be, and I think they're general. I mean, that, and that's also part of the character of this type of report. But I think they need to be dealt with much more specifically in terms of different countries, different types. If I'd had more time, I would have said something about the differences between central Kenya and northern Ghana, for instance, and smallholder realities in different places in terms of what types of policies are relevant. And I think this needs to be... If it is to be operationalized at the country level, it needs to be thought out very carefully in terms of a strategy of some sort.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. And thank you for indulging me and letting me get a question. Please, from the audience, Ngolia.
Okay. It's very bright.
It is awful.
Can I be behind you?
Yeah, right.
Thank you very much, Agnes, for an excellent presentation. My question is, you mentioned that one of the important factors is actually how you influence policy making in these countries that you carry out most of your panel data research. I wonder, how does your own research feed into the policy making in the various countries that you're doing research? And have you seen any impact of, for instance, taking up some of your recommendations?
I think for the second round, we had the CADEP, Yes, the CADEP representative from NEPAD was part of our advisory group, but that was in 2008. And as we know, quite a lot has happened since then. What we see, I don't know if it's been taken up concretely as such. I know there was our Nigerian counterpart wrote something that was used as a political level, as far as I know. But what we've tried to do is look at the influence of policy in terms of can we see an outcome in the livelihoods, basically, or in production levels or fertilizer uptake and that sort of thing. And we've looked at different types of connections, and we can't really find any evidence of this actually hitting sort of the smallholder sector. But I think it's too early to evaluate. I think that would be at the macro level, the budget allocations to agriculture have been increasing. We can sort of see examples. If you drive around, you can see things being built and initiatives being taken and so on. But among the households that we interview, we haven't seen any real changes in that sense. And I think it's, as I mentioned, we'll be collecting data in 2013 in four countries, Malawi, Zambia, Kenya, and Ghana. And my guess would be that we would probably see a bit more by now than 5 years ago or 4 years ago. So at least we can hope so. But other than that, I think our policy discussions have been mainly with SIDA, so much directly with. And then I know that our African counterparts, so in Malawi, for instance, we're going to present our results in at the ministry in October. So, I mean, they do a fair bit of sort of presenting of results to their country ministry. But we haven't done that as sort of the Swedish research.
Okay, thank you. Are there more questions or comments? Microphone, please.
Yeah, sorry. Then I cannot measure.
No.
We have seen this diagram on fertilizers utilization in different regions of the world, and definitely the industrialized world, largest consumer of fertilizer, and the South African countries 4.2 there. Considering this, the clean development mechanism, shouldn't we pay the developing countries for the use of fertilizers we have to compensate the use they don't have?
Good luck, Agnes. this is stump government. Go ahead.
I'm not sure that was a question. I think that was a comment.
Oh, it was a comment. Oh, that's a way
I'll
out.
Interpret
it. Oh, very good. Okay, yeah. That's very difficult.
Sorry, on sustainable agriculture, and what is sustainability? Is it sustainable to use this kind of fertilizers or not, and so on? It is more related to that.
I don't know.
We could say that it is, what we do in the developing world is not sustainable in that regard. I mean, only that. And this is more sustainable, what they do what they don't use. Of course, they are paying with this hunger and the starving and that they are not using.
Yeah.
This is my conception.
Yeah, I understand your question. Does anyone from the commission want to respond to that? No, I think... the general way of looking at it in the debate, if you let me hop in here to save you, is that we overuse it and they underuse it. But the fact that we overuse it doesn't give us the moral right to tell them they can't use it at all. I think that's sort of the political discussion that's going on about fertilizer. But then, of course, it gets much more complicated when it becomes subsidized fertilizer. Then you start asking other questions. Okay, more comments. Questions. Do we have any from the cyberspace here? Okay, good.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could just elaborate a little bit more about the links between urban and rural food security. Talked about in the.
Is that your question or is it cyber?
No, it's been okay. Retweeted several times.
Okay, I was just wondering if you'd like to detail this a little more, or should I just say something briefly about the links?
I don't think that would
okay.
So quickly.
Okay. well, the links between urban and rural food systems. If we look at our data, and this was done only for the 2008 data, we added a set of questions on transfers of food between, or actually from the rural households rather than to urban households, because we don't have data from the urban. And it turned out that about 40% of the households that grow maize, and we looked at the staple crops because they're easier to transfer, actually send food to relatives that are not living with them in the villages. And so we have large amounts of food that are actually leaving the rural homesteads, being eaten somewhere else. If I remember correctly, it's not possible to specify by volume how much goes to the urban areas, how much goes to other rural areas, but something like 50% of the respondents said, well, we're sending food to the rural area, to the urban area. And the point there is that, I've looked at who sends this food. You'd expect it perhaps to be the very rich households who do have a surplus would be able to send some food to other relatives. But it's actually, it's throughout the sample. It's regardless of income. And the most vulnerable households actually, in relative terms, send as much as the richest household. So you have a situation of basically the family stretching outside the village. So whatever is produced is used to feed family members outside the village. And that, of course, has implications. If you design something like a vulnerable, like this program in Ethiopia, the safety net program, if your intention is to target the very vulnerable households, if you can't see these transfers, how would you know who to target? So these transfers, unless you collect data on them in the way we've done, they're invisible, and they fall outside the market sort of mechanism. And still, they're a very important part of the food system for the urban areas and for other areas, for more vulnerable rural areas. So they have implications for the sending households in terms of food security that are not visible unless you ask specifically about it. And if you probe sort of qualitatively, if you ask the farmers, well, they will just say, well, this is part of our household consumption. My household isn't here. And this is an old debate in studies, well, where is the household exactly? But they sort of perceive it as part of the consumption burden of the household, but it's being spread across space.
Wrap up this and move on. Do you have any more comments that have been retweeted? I like that word.
That was the main one.
That was the main one. Okay, very good. I think we need to move on then to our next speakers, who will be giving examples of climate change initiative. First, thank you very much, Agnes. And good luck with your future research. Now, do we have Elwin Granger Jones somewhere here? Yes, I can. Very sort of in the background. May you speak more directly in the microphone?
Okay.
Good. Now I hear you. But now I don't see you.
All right, let me move.
Can't have everything.
Okay. Which you prefer? Can you see both now? Can you see me and hear me now?
Yes, you're rather off in a corner. Can you? Yeah, there. Now, perfect view. And perfect sound. Thank you very much. So, the floor is yours.
Thanks. Look, thanks for including me in this. It was really interesting to listen in. The starting point is that looking at the Commission on Sustainable Agriculture and Climate Change, it really brought together a clear storyline, which as a practitioner in this area, I really appreciate. And that wasn't an easy task because things have been changing and moving so quickly in this debate about what's the interface between climate change and agriculture more generally and environmental issues even more generally. To really crudely characterize my sense of where things have been shifting is that we've had a very helpful shift in that debate from perhaps a few years ago, the climate change issue being seen as largely a carbon markets issue that revolved around, agriculture or how can carbon markets be brought into agriculture through a sort of debate within the UNFCCC, which is quite a narrow, specific thing, to really placing climate change as something that really transforms the context for everything that we do in this area. This we've set out quite hopefully also clearly in IFAD's new climate change strategy and our environment and natural resource management policy. I mean, I'm often asked by our country program managers, you know, is this whole climate thing sort of old wine in new bottles? What's really different about this? Because we've been doing drought management, drought tolerance, rural development for years. And I think that's the right question to ask, actually. I think there's a lot of demystifying that needs to be done around this whole issue. And that's what I think the Commission helped us do in providing this narrative. What I tend to say in response, by the way, is that climate change is really transforming the risk profile for all our work. So we can't just use historical drought frequencies. We can't use the familiar risks that we were comfortable with. We need to think about new risks, like sea level rise is already having a major impact in many of the places we're working. We need to look at longer run risks and really, you know, how we help communities manage when there's so much uncertainty about what climate change is going to do to that community. That's why we're often now talking about building adaptive capacity as opposed to a specific investment based on certainty about what's going to happen in that area. So a lot more risk management, and secondly, a kind of huge scale up in the successful sustainable agriculture practices that have been piloted around the world for years. We think those are really ready for scale up, and that's not just scale up of a bunch of technical interventions. It's also changing a way of thinking actually about agriculture, which again the Commission set out, and that's really systems thinking. It's not thinking around specific crops or specific projects. It's thinking about landscapes, ecosystems. Because if you have narrow systems thinking, your response to climate change will be wrong. You'll be just simply looking at how do we produce rice in a more, for example, saline tolerant way without looking at whether rice is the best crop, for example. It's possibly leading to maladaptation. And the third is that we need to very much change the way we measure what we do, not just looking at traditional indicators of food production, even what are often short-term poverty reduction in project areas, but having a much wider frame, looking at things like the emission impacts, looking at things like impacts on biodiversity, on climate resilience, where the indicators are very and not yet developed about how you would measure the resilience of communities. We're working hard on that. So, you know, one initiative I wanted to share in building on that was something that IFAD has been developing with a number of donors over the last year or so, which is trying to create a way for fast-track climate finance to be used to stimulate this big scale-up of sustainable agriculture, based on a sense we have that a lot of that finance is not getting to the smallholder communities, and its smallholder is sort of the focus for IFAD in our lending and grant programs. So we've developed this initiative called the Adaptation for Smallholder Agriculture Program, ASAP, and it really tries to take climate finance and use it in a grant form to stimulate, to provide in a sense a shock stimulus through our programs to increase the amount of the overall IFAD portfolio that's spent on climate resilience. And we commit about $1 billion a year into smallholder agriculture. And if we can get a significant share of that to be much more explicitly focused on building climate resilience through things like better landscape management, we think that will be a good thing and will be a good example of the kind of partnerships that are needed. And this is where GDPRD really needs to help us, because our sense is that we've got much of the technical knowledge, not all of it, that's needed to confront climate change, or at least the kind of climate change we're going to experience for the next 10, 20, 30 years. Our main challenge is actually mindset. And to respond, to be able to change mindsets requires an enormous collective effort around knowledge management and advocacy work. And that's where any one organization acting alone simply won't be successful. And that's where partnerships like ASAT, which is a partnership, for example, between an agriculture-focused development organization with donors, is the kind of thing that we need to kind of be creative and look at ways to bring together, for example, finance and institutions with smallholders. So I really hope to see GDPRD doing a lot more of this kind of work. And, you know, it's important for us to recognize that this work, yes, needs to try and build awareness of smallholders and agriculture more generally in the UNFCCC and the environment context such as Rio, and we're working hard on that, but not take our eye off the main challenge, which is to reform our houses from within. It's the agriculture community that really still has some way to go in embracing climate change and understanding what it means for us in the context of our wider agronomic and understanding of agriculture. And that's where there's an awful lot we can still do working together to have an impact on that. Thank you.
Thank you. That was very brief. Okay. you said so many interesting things. I think that perhaps I would ask you, take my privilege as moderator here, to develop a couple of things here that you said. One, you said that IFAD is using climate finance as a shock stimulus. What do you mean by shock stimulus? Sounds uncomfortable.
Well, it depends from what perspective you see it. The what we hope to do, so I need to turn the volume down, I'm getting feedback here. What we're trying to do is to absorb as an extra, in a sense, window in our core replenishment of IFAD, which is a 3-year cycle. We've created this extra window called ASAP, where donors with earmarked climate or environment finance can make a contribution to our core programs in a way that we wouldn't otherwise be able to receive. In a sense, we've created an extra way to absorb that finance. And what we will then do is manage, in a sense, a competitive process internally such that a large share or a share of IFAD's new investments will receive an additional grant, which is extremely attractive to partner governments and to our country programs. But that will come with, in a sense, some expectation that the investment which we will be co-financing, and of course the grant itself, will enable climate resilience to be really fundamentally addressed through that program. So we'll be, in a sense, using this finance to incentivize what we aim for will be a doubling of the share of IFAD's new lending on environments and natural resource management activities, for example. So in a sense, it's an internal incentive, and that's where actually grant finance can be an extremely powerful incentive in development finance organizations, because some of our finance is provided in the form of extremely concessional lending. And there is some reluctance by governments, which I understand completely, to, in a sense, pay for the extra cost of climate resilient investments through any kind of lending operation, even if it's highly concessional. And that's where the grant finance can unlock doing a whole bunch of different and new things in a larger investment operation.
Okay. So it's the doubling that's the shock, not the... Anything
yeah.
else? Very good. Questions from the floor? Here. Comments? Questions from our cyberspace? If not, I have another. Oh, well, here we do. Sorry, Hannah.
Hi, my name is Hannah Wetterstrand. I'm working for the Swedish Cooperative Center and an organization called the VI Agroforestry Program, working around Lake Victoria with agroforestry mainly. And we have developed a specific project that is measuring the amount of carbon that could be stored in the soil through agroforestry or sustainable agricultural land use management practices. And so we have done this in order to try to see whether there is
more funding to be found within the climate funds, so to say. And you just started by saying that this report actually opens up the whole involvement of agriculture in climate change, in the climate change debate. And so my question to you is, or if you could just say in general, what kind of potential you think that carbon finance or the role of carbon finance in finding an agriculture that is more resilient to climate change in general, especially for small scale farmers.
Okay, thanks for that question. My sense is that the whole question of carbon finance and climate smart agriculture, or even agriculture and rural development more generally, needs to be handled with extreme caution. On the one hand, we need to try and find ways that through which smallholder farmers who are already acting as ecosystem managers and can do better, therefore have an important impact on emissions, should be rewarded for those impacts. But we need to be extremely careful that what currently look like quite small income streams don't distort the whole debate, don't lead to a sense that smallholder farmers and agriculture more generally should only do the kind of things that are necessary to reform agriculture, sustainable agriculture, simply for the reasons of accessing carbon finance. It somehow communicates that this isn't good for us anywhere. Whereas in reality, most of the projects I've seen where we've been trying to access carbon finance from largely the voluntary markets, it's such a small income stream. It's really only the icing on the cake, and it's not what determines the decision about that particular investment. It's something that helps. And sometimes, actually, the rules are such, I have been hearing, that it sort of limits the flexibility of the smallholder farmers to evolve and change, for example, their use of agroforestry techniques over time. So, I mean, we see it as an important long-run objective to have smallholders access these, so long as it's done equitably, it's done where their tenure arrangements are clear, and so long as it doesn't distort the debate. For us, actually, the main debate around all of this is not centered around the UNFCCC or carbon finance. It's really centered around what is the best agricultural and food system and what's in our interest. And what we've seen is that most of the practices which lead to reduced emissions tend actually to be in the interests of smallholder farmers anyway. There are some examples where they're not, especially if we single-mindedly focus on emissions, which we would never intend to do. So it's what some describe as a multiple benefit. But for us, it would not be the entry point in our engagement with those communities. It's a wonderful co-benefit, and it's a co-benefit that we should measure so that when we explain the benefits of development finance to donors and governments, and the role of smallholders, we can say, here's the impact we have. But it won't be the thing that actually determines what we do. It's a, by lucky coincidence, in our view, best practice agriculture also happens to be low emission agriculture. So in the long run, the most productive form of agriculture for us will be the lower emission form of agriculture. It wasn't actually planned that way in many cases. So that gives us comfort that we don't necessarily need, but would like to see, carbon finance flows incentivizing that, but we can start anyway, and we've got to.
Okay, thank you for that. I would just like to mention to those who are here that the program ASAP that Edwin is referring to, we do have a publication about that, and we also have an occasional paper that you are the author of called Climate Smart Smallholder Agriculture, What's Different? So I would, we do have, we will need to bring in Paris here in a moment for comments. but your climate smart smallholder agriculture, what's different? Could you just tell us briefly what is different since you wrote it?
Mute off. I sort of covered that a bit before, and I should plug the launch of that paper tomorrow, which is at 3 p.m. And it's going to be webcast, and this is, I think, what you've got, and it would be great to have people listening in and participating in that. It's sort of what I mentioned. It's that people ask me, is it old wine in new bottles? I say it's 80% old wine in a new bottle, cut with a sort of very strong 20% new variety of wine, of new grape, which really changed the taste of all of the wine. What I mean by that is, if you are climate aware when we are working with any policy or any project, it really changes the context so fundamentally in many cases that while you may use many of the familiar techniques in responding to it, you'll be using them subtly different. For example, I'll give you a couple of recent examples. Just the last 2 weeks I was working with IFAD, where there's a program in Senegal where we've been working with a community that's been experiencing quite significant sea level rise. It's really quite striking how sea level rise is already having an impact on many low-lying communities. This was something I certainly hadn't appreciated a few years back. And that's leading to all kinds of salinization problems for the soil, and leading to all kinds of problems with the soil fertility. And so, you know, in the absence of climate change and sea level rise, we would have been doing something quite different in that area. We'd been doing much more sort of traditional form of sustainable land management, looking at how to produce in more arid, in a more arid environment, because the ICET line has moved south 120 kilometers over Senegal. But now we're doing something quite different. We have to have all kinds of processes to try and stop that salinization of the soil and wash the soil, and it's a completely different kind of intervention. So the context is changing sufficiently that when you think about the context and plan ahead for it, you end up using tools that aren't entirely new in many cases, but you're using them quite differently. Another example, just yesterday, one of my team got back from Togo, where the crisis in the Sahel has led to a real increase in transhuman pastoralism, where that's leading to all kinds of local conflicts between smallholder farmers and the pastoralists, which is leading to all kinds of maladaptation techniques. For example, many farmers are actually burning all the grass around their fields to stop the cows, to stop the cattle being attracted to that area, thus ruining their crops, which is having all kinds of effects on soil fertility and biodiversity. So, in trying to respond to one problem of climate change, there's another one being created, and a project in that area is therefore quite different than in the absence of it. So I guess what I'll be saying in more depth tomorrow is that being aware of this change risk context means using different tools in projects and policy design and development planning, which will lead to a different kind of response, which in our view will probably involve much more recourse to sustainable agriculture techniques and landscape management than were used in the past. Mm-hmm. And thirdly, a different way of measuring impact, so that we don't measure impacts in a narrow way that kind of reflects the narrow way in which government ministries, the international architecture, which divides things between agriculture and environment, have traditionally been practiced. We need to demonstrate value for money for the use of development finance. We've got to now demonstrate that it isn't achieving one thing at the expense of another. Mm-hmm. And that requires a much more challenging monitoring and evaluation effort. Yes. Than we've seen in the past, where we've got to measure things like emissions. Even if that's not the driving force for our intervention.
Yeah.
We've got to measure things like biodiversity. extremely difficult to measure.
Definitely.
We've got to measure local pollution impacts. So that's the kind of thing we need to do.
Okay. I want you to hang in there. Now that we're on the subject of different counter impacts and looking at these, I want to briefly give the word back to Paris here.
Yes.
Marion, if you're here. I'd like you to have a response to a response, as I understand.
It was just when the lady was talking about our report and the fact that we didn't look at local specificity. In fact, in a short report, you never put all what you should put. But as you have seen in the summary of our report, we tried to be quite specific. For instance, when we gave some examples of what is food insecurity, we are quite convinced that before giving solutions, you need to have a quite specific diagnosis about the source of the insecurity. And that's why we explained that maybe in Vietnam, the source was the monsoon, that in India, the losses of the harvest because of the packaging and so on. And so we gave quite practical examples because, of course, our commission was composed of 13 members coming from very different places in the world. So it was possible to try to characterize the sources of unsafety, if you want, non-safety. And of course, we have not been local because in a report of 10 pages, you cannot be specific. But I think that in every paragraph, we have talked about the local conditions. So I don't pretend that our report is perfect. It is not, of course. But I'm sure that we have looked at food security from very specific geographical diverse point of views.
Okay.
That's what I wanted to add when the previous speakers made this criticism.
Yeah, thank you for that. And it's very interesting to know that of the general, I think it's an accomplishment in itself that you can boil this down to 7 recommendations. And one of it may be a bit on the general, but on the other hand, it puts it keeps everyone from developing all kinds of side issues, and otherwise the debate becomes very messy if we don't keep ourselves.
Yes, that's it.
To a number.
You need to be efficient to be understood, but we agree that the analysis of food insecurity needs to be locally specified.
Yeah. Okay. Both sides are right then. Thank you very much for that input. Elwin, are you still there? We'll go back to you then if we have...
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, good. We got in the commercial break there where you're promoting your latest publication for tomorrow and hope that everyone heard that. it's no problem. I had one last quick question for you, and that's being, I'm from an agricultural network and I'm an agriculturalist, and you made, and this, I just need a quick answer to this because we have to go on to our next speaker. You said the agriculture community needs to embrace climate change. How have we not embraced climate change? Why have we not done it? And what? And will this report then from the Commission help us to do that?
Wow, a quick answer to that one.
Right. You're on the spot.
we've got to embrace climate change. I guess the first bit's simple. We've got to do it because whether it's 2 degrees or the current trajectory, at least according to IEA, of 6 degrees based on emissions over the last few years, it's going to have a huge impact on our work. Second point, why have we not embraced it, is a much more difficult one. I think it's just the newness of the issue. I think it's that when we first started talking about climate change, there was all this stuff about, which to me is almost an excessively complicating factor, that it was introduced through the context of carbon markets, which are just kind of complex things and they have all kinds of acronyms. As it, what the language that was used, the messaging was not designed to be clear, was not designed with an agriculture audience in mind. It was designed with a UNFCCC audience in mind through the specific objective of influencing those negotiations. So it wasn't an agronomic message that particularly made sense to the wider agriculture community. Where that's evolving, although I still think we've got a bit of work to go. I guess the second reason why it hasn't sort of yet been sort of universally embraced is there's still a bit of confusion, and my personal sense is that some of the mindsets of those working in this sector were very much formed during the era of the Green Revolution, and some of the, you know, university syllabuses around agriculture, which partly sort of populated the extension systems and etc., you know, very much had a frame of mind of agriculture as a sort of manufacturing activity with economies of scale to be reached, high inputs, and this is probably an overcharacterization, but that whole mindset doesn't lend itself easily to what we're saying needs to be done for agriculture to be climate resilient. So the climate smart agriculture message doesn't sit that comfortably with what was the previous kind of paradigm around agriculture. So it wasn't easily accommodated. What can we do to make it have sort of wider understanding? Sort of what we're doing. I think we need to be careful about two specific labels, whether we call it climate smart agriculture or something else. We need a much better communication effort. We need that effort to be focused, in my view, much more on the sort of core agriculture community than perhaps in the past, where most of our efforts were around influencing the UNFCCC process, although we've still got to do both. So a lot of communications, a lot of advocacy work, and a lot of sensitization with developing country partners that we need to talk about this, not because we're insisting they've got to reduce their emissions footprint, because smallholders are not the driver of the major share of agriculture emissions, but because emissions are a byproduct, and we're really talking about poverty reduction and adapting to this pretty dreadful thing that is happening.
Okay, those optimistic words. Thank you very much for your input. We need to move on to our DFID representative, David Howlett. Are you with us?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, very well. And now, if the technicians will put a picture up there, that would be nice too.
On Skype, so hopefully.
Oh, yes. Work. Okay, now we see you and hear you.
Okay, so anyway, thanks for inviting me, and also greetings from it's my kitchen in North Yorkshire. So,
okay.
So, anyway, I've been listening in, so it's been a very interesting discussion. I think I need to say the next slide. Do you have my slides up?
Yes, they're up. We see them.
Yeah, okay, the next slide, the second one. Really, I think Mary and Agnes and Elwyn probably said all the things I was planning to say, so I can sort of excuse myself by not coming to all the detail, but a couple of things really. One, to thank Mary and also Molly for your work on the commission and the very useful set and clear set of findings. And Elwyn sort of talked a bit about how we can use those. I think the importance of focus on smallholders. The other thing which is also important, which was coming out, is this is a report for all agriculture, not just developing. It's all about how do we change and get sustainable agriculture in developed countries. I now wanted to really sort of take a bit further forward on what, as a bilateral, that the United Kingdom is doing. And so sort of pick up from what Elwyn's been talking about. You know, the UK is, you know, taking action. We've met all our commitments which we made at Aquila. We've committed over or dispersed about 1.2 billion on food security, so we are taking action. But I wanted more to sort of focus a bit on what we're doing around our International Climate Fund. So go to the next slide. This really picks up on, I think, Molly, what you were asking Elwyn that last question, that we really see there are two actions. One is to get climate change into agriculture policies and programs, and Elwyn's spoken about some of the challenges of that. The second is, how do we get agriculture into climate change policies and finance? So more broadly, DFID is looking at how do we climate with all our development programs. So it's not just an agriculture issue. It's about how do we address climate change across the whole development programs. So what we see we need to do, you know, you want to get climate change into what we do. And as Owen was saying, it isn't business as usual. I did like his analogy around the new wine in old bottles. I'm not sure how that would go down with mixing French and Australian and South African and wines from Chile, but maybe it makes it better. But so we really need to sort of get climate change into what we're doing around the G8 and G20 on food security, what we're doing in supporting CADAP in Africa. Again, the long-term issues are on research. You know, it is going to be business unusual. So support to the CGIAR climate change and security program and other research is important. And then what is happening to a national level in terms of national policies, both in developed and also in developing countries. Then also, what are the multilaterals like IFAD, the World Bank, FAO, WFP and other institutions doing around bringing climate change into what they're doing? Then I think where we started on this particular Globe Donor platform when I was involved a few years ago, we did focus a lot on the UNFCCC, the negotiations and NAMAs and NAPAs and climate finance. I think that's important, but I think we do need to do the two things, getting agriculture policies right as well as climate change policies and financing right. So next slide, please. So I really want to sort of come a bit to what the UK has been doing around the sort of the climate financing side. After Copenhagen, we committed to £2.9 billion over 3 years for Fast Start funding. And there you can see that the split which we focused on. We're recognising that adaptation is crucial. So 50% is going on there, 30% on low carbon, 20% on forestry and to halt deforestation and degradation. So that's our International Climate Fund. It's we're now into the second year of this program. I'm going to give you some more details. Next slide, please. Elwin already mentioned the issue of value for money, but I wanted to sort of focus on results and results and results. We are in times when, you know, finances are tight. We need to deliver on results. So for the International Climate Fund, these are our sort of headline indicators. You know, one is focus is really on the people first. I won't read those, or perhaps I should read that because people might be listening. One is how making people better able to cope with the effects of climate change, number of people access to clean and also sustainable energy. And then on the environment, tons of CO2 reduced or avoided, clean energy, number of hectares where deforestation and degradation have been avoided, and also the importance of valuing ecosystems. So those are some of our headline indicators that all the programs under ICF focus on. But again, it is about taking action, and this is, I think, where picking up on the Commission is action is needed. And also, I do like IFAD's acronym ASAP. It also stands for as soon as possible. So I think we do need to take action. Let me come on to a bit on what our adaptation priorities for our climate funds. Again, we set out seven areas: agriculture, disaster risk reduction, sort of water resource management, infrastructure and urban issues, coastal zones, social protection, and also the impacts of climate change on health, specifically around diseases and issues of malnutrition. So those are our focuses. I'm only going to now focus really on agriculture and what we're doing. Elwin's already talked about the term climate smart agriculture. We are using that, and we're using it in this broad sense to say we want to achieve all these things. Maybe sometimes there will be trade-offs, but we want to support people's livelihoods, particularly smallholders, and to get economic growth, particularly green growth out of agriculture. We obviously need the food that farmers and consumers need, and that's a global issue. Improving people's nutrition, particularly for women and children. And again, adapting farmers to existing and future climate risks. This is where business unusual will start to change. The IPCC report has already highlighted that you're going to have increased droughts and floods, and this is going to impact on farming and farmers. Maintaining the health of our land so it can maintain or increase productivity, the important aspect of biodiversity, maintaining our forests and not losing biodiversity. And then as a co-benefit, sequestering carbon into soils and biomass so we can also reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So that's what we understand by climate smart. And that, I think, is very akin to sustainable agriculture. Sustainable intensification also, I think, comes under this, particularly when you take all those goals. So that's what we're trying to do. Next slide, please. So just one example. This is a very new program which was launched this year, Climate Resilient Agriculture in Africa. It focused a lot on conservation farming, use of agroforestry and soil and water conservation measures. It's implemented by those three regional organizations, COMESA, EAC and SADC. And it's to support 2 million farmers, and it's going to focus on results. So we're really wanting this to reduce numbers of people suffering from food insecurity in Southern Africa by up to 5 million and reduce malnutrition in children by 50%, particularly around reducing stunting. So that's just a sort of an example of what we're doing. I wanted now just to sort of finish a little bit on what we're planning. But before saying that, to just underline the costs of not doing anything, I think IID estimated that by 2050, that'd be about 5% of the world's GDP. So it's a tremendous cost which we need to tackle, and it's also a human cost. So what are we doing? We're looking at developing new global regional national programs, looking at what the multilaterals are doing, and looking at the program that IFAD is developing. Also crucially is how do we engage the private sector? Obviously farmers are all small, medium enterprises, but how do we engage the whole private sector to deliver and adapt agriculture and get growth? Important to us, and this is for the Global Donor Platform and also other partners, civil society and private sector, how do we share lessons on how to adapt and how to scale up these sustainable agriculture approaches? And also we are looking for agriculture being included under UNFCCC, and note that this is going to be again discussed in the COP at the end of the year in Qatar. We're also making sure we're joined up with links across to the G8, where the UK holds the presidency, and we're maintaining focus on food security, and pleased to launch the new Alliance for Food Security and Nutrition in Washington last month. And also looking at what will come out of Rio in relation to the sustainable development goals around food and agriculture. And then importantly is the post-energy framework. What happens after 2015? Thanks, Molly and colleagues, for listening.
Okay. Thank you very much for that presentation. Okay. Just one point to clear up. I missed what you had to say about the cost of not doing anything. Could you repeat that information, please?
It's estimated that 5% of the world's GDP by 2050 if we don't adapt agriculture to climate change. Obviously, it's a I think it was done by IID a couple of years ago.
So we'll lose that 5% then. We'll have a 5% reduction.
If we don't adapt agriculture.
Okay. Thank you. I missed that. All right. Open for questions and comments here. Please.
Hi again. My name is Hanna Wettersson, working for Swedish Cooperative Center. I just want to bring back the discussion again to the UNCCC and the prospects you see, because what I've seen so far, it's still very much focused on carbon credits and getting more carbon finance and having a trade on with carbon emission. Do you see any prospects of the dialogue there to actually be broadened and starting to talk more maybe about various getting more money to those green fund and adaptation fund, etc. And what is your view on maybe having an agricultural working program?
Yeah, well, I think that the UK's position is the same. You know, is obviously, of course, the EU, we would like a work program on agriculture, and it must cover adaptation and mitigation. So the recent discussions in Bonn almost reached agreement around that. I think there is, and Owen's highlighted it, that people came into UNFCCC thinking around carbon markets in relation to agriculture. I think that is, agriculture needs to be much bigger than that. And it's just a potential opportunity. I think particularly for smallholders, the idea that carbon financing is going to be a sudden quick win, I think is maybe misconstrued. And the issue is, particularly for developing countries, to focus on the adaptation mitigation side. I think progress has been made in municipal seed. You know, agriculture is being discussed. Maybe I'd flag a paper that Molly and Marion, myself and others wrote at the beginning of the year in Science of what next for agriculture, because that sets out the political economy around what we see around the negotiations. So there's a whole set of issues, and if you want to look at it, it's in 17th of January in Science.
Okay. Has DFID actually increased its agricultural portfolio in recent years? Is investment increasing in agriculture-related?
Yes, it is. I haven't got the figures to hand. Obviously, we did make a significant commitment at L'Aquila in 2009. The money from the International Climate Fund is new money. It's not sort of, you know, old wine in new bottles, to go back to Elwin's analogy. And it is, you know, we're picking up from the US on food security, and obviously colleagues in France on the G20 and now Mexico are also looking at food security, so looking for the G20 to take these forward. So I think, you know, we are looking to increase our investments, and I think we have, but I haven't got the precise figures for me.
That's all right. I was reading a news article here recently that the L'Aquila initiative has only actually disbursed a little over 20% of the money it pledged in 2009.
Yeah. The UK's, we committed 1.1 billion and we've actually disbursed 1.2 billion.
Oh, well, then you're on the happy side of the statistic.
So we will be encouraging other members to also meet their commitments.
Uh-huh. Encouraging. I like that. I won't ask you to define that word.
I don't have the details of which other countries have or have, but obviously it is challenging times in relation to some of the G8 economies and others. But
yeah,
the focus is, you know, UK recognise, focus on smallholders and the food security effects of poorers. Now is the time to maintain investments and not to reduce them.
Okay. Do we have any comments from the? Okay, Matthew.
Yeah, we had one posing. From the Twitter was, you said, how can we engage the private sector in development and growth in agriculture? And I was just wondering if you could tell us how.
Well, let me give you an example. We're supporting the African Enterprise Challenge Fund, which is managed by out of Agra in Nairobi. That's sort of contributing to developing partnerships with the private sector. For example, in, I think, Sierra Leone, it's led to partnerships in some private sector and cocoa farmers, bringing incomes to farmers. So there's that area. Obviously, also in some of the programs, we have small and medium enterprises. I think we've got some there from the cooperatives. So there's a whole set of others in that sort of private sector, civil society, where they need to engage. Obviously, markets and transportation is all, you know, in the private sector. And not just, you know, not talking about, you know, the sort of the large multinationals or the supermarkets, but, you know, the seed companies and the whole set of actors who can really help drive growth and benefit livelihoods for smallholders. And also, they also need to be thinking about how they adapt in the future to climate change.
Okay, one more, yeah?
Just got a follow-up to that. What about the big businesses in the UK, for example, such as the large supermarkets? Shouldn't they also be becoming involved in this?
I think the answer is yes. I think, interestingly, I went to, but there was a sort of a dragon's den thing around with what to do around development, and it had the private sector, civil society, and one of the winning bids was actually came from Walmart Asda, saying that they need to engage with smallholders and looking to source products from smallholders. Obviously, there's a whole set of issues, but, you know, we need to source products from developing countries, and they need to be sustainable and ethical. So there is a big, you know, there's obviously a clear role for people like Asda and Tesco's and Sainsbury's and others. We're also looking, you know, in Rio Plus 20 for more sort of reporting on sustainability. So there's a number of examples like, you know, Marks and Spencer's and others. There's Unilever's commitments. So things are moving ahead, and they do have a clear role to play.
All right. Thank you very much. I can see by the kitchen clock there that I'm running close to schedule.
Yeah.
And we're going to have a brief wrap-up session. I'd like to invite Brian and Cheshtin back up to the podium and wrap up the discussion for today. Okay. And thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much. I'll put myself on mute so it doesn't ring again.
Okay.
Thank you. We're closing, as Melinda just mentioned, and I wanted, on behalf of the platform, just to pull together a few closing remarks from our perspective, if I may. And as ever, when I things of process and things of content. This has been a three-hour interaction hosted by CEDA, which we're very, very grateful for. But I think it's an important lesson for us of how we go about networking with you, one of our members. And as you've seen, how we network with our own members as well. The technical ways we do it, and you can see the Skype work better from DFID than the video conferencing from EFAD, for example. But the content, which is a fact, I mean, then this is something that we learn about because we want to be better at managing and transferring knowledge and how we interact with an audience. So I think this has been a very important process for us, and I very much hope it's shown to you as members of the platform what you can get from the platform and stimulated you an audience both in Sweden and in Finland about how you would like to interact and ask questions from the platform. And you've been seeing how easy it is today for you to ask questions of the Commission, of IFAD, and of DFID in London. In terms of content, I found that last hour or so, well, since we're up, tremendously helpful for me as a development practitioner. I thought to have, you know, Marianne's overview, as she said, a short document where they brought together a very diverse audience, but a big subject into those recommendations was terribly helpful. But then I found Agnes's presentation from University of Lund, maybe it's because I'm a geographer from years ago, absolutely spot on. I mean, a very good analysis of what the problems were. I really appreciate that focus on the why. But also, that was one of the first critiques I've heard of the Commission's work. And I think we need to engage. If the Commission's recommendations are going to live and be sustainable and be used, they have to be understood, they have to be critiqued, they have to be taken forward. And since we discussed them, first of all, at the platform's AGA in Berlin, that's the first time I've seen that analysis begin. So I really welcome that from Agnes and the University of Lund. And I also welcome my colleague Elwin, who I only met, you know, 24 hours ago in Rome, for talking about that 80-20. That a lot of this is old wine, but there's a very important 20%, which is the new variety, which is really changing the taste and what we do with that product. And again, thanking Elwin for emphasizing what the platform's role is going to be about changing people's mindsets. That if we are going to make the changes that we want to do and make people's behavior change, an individual organization, be it civil society, private sector, donor, or government, cannot do it alone. It has to be done in partnership. And the platform is a tremendous vehicle for that form of partnership going forward. And again, those last comments about that was brought forward by Melinda's question, why haven't we done this before? I hadn't been thinking about, to be honest, how we've been distracted by the carbon market issue at the behest of the UNFCCC trying to get a post-Kyoto accord, when we should have been focusing on what does this mean for agriculture. And then again, as I was emphasizing this morning, David's comments from London about the importance of giving results. We've got to show results from our work in adaptation in the climate sector and the being climate smart. And that we have to look, as Agnes was saying, as we develop those priorities, that they're gender smart and they address the issues of risk, that risk to the small farmer are changing, the way that farm smallholders interpret that risk for climate change is coming forward. And to end on the issue of what the platform's role into this, as David was saying, the UK is hosting the G8. We've seen the importance of the G8 in Washington this year, that we got agriculture was on the agenda in terms of the cabinet process, and the voluntary guidelines for agriculture and the responsible agriculture investment principles were part of the G8 declaration. Reflect and imagine what we can do if we can get climate smart agriculture into the G8 presidency of the UK next year. Now there's an advocacy challenge for us as members of the platform. So in closing, again, thank you for spending 3 hours with us this afternoon. Many thanks for CEDA for hosting this excellent event, and we look forward to working with you again in the future. Thank you.
So after that, I don't have very much to add, but I wanted to add a few things from the CEDA perspective too. Of course, this roadshow 3-hour thing has been a thrilling experience, I would say, from the very start. And I would like to say that this has been possible to do thanks to the platform secretariat, thanks to Avi Huset, and thanks to the patient participants over video and Skype that has been waiting behind but being ready to speak when time was there. The technique was with us today, so I'm very happy that this could work out. And again, thanks to Avi Huset that was here the day before yesterday and early in the morning to settle things. And content-wise, I also would like to say a few things without mentioning anybody in particular. All the different deliberations have been very rich and very have given a lot of food for thought. I picked up a few sentences. The I think it was Elvin saying that there is quite a lot of demystifying or demystification being needed around agriculture and climate change, and also someone else, I think it was David, saying that we need to bring agriculture into climate change and climate change into agriculture, and this is really a challenge that we have to do. And from a CEDA perspective, I want to mention that we have actually taken up this as a priority for this year's operational plan 2012. We are particularly working now with resilience and disaster risk reduction and increasing resilience, and with a special focus on agriculture and water. And what we are working with in this working group right now is also to focus on the recurrent crisis, not the big disaster tsunamis, but the recurrent crisis like the Sahel and the Horn of Africa. And after today's interaction, again, we have learned to know about different partners that we easily now will get in touch with, both IFAD and DFID. We knew that they were working on the same issues, but thanks to the platform again and the platform participants, we have a network easy to work from. And I think that was what I brought with me from today. And I also have appreciated very much the lively participation from everyone here, also over the Twitter. We had extensive participation from the civil society organization that is always welcome. And I also want to say thank you to the moderators. Moderator Melinda and the Twitter moderator Matthew, thank you so much. Also for the support from Siani logistically to have you present here. Thank you for that. If I have forgotten anyone, I hope you feel included in the thank you. And with this, we'll finish off this day with a film exactly. there. Do you want to say a few words about it? After the film, there is coffee available outside with something, and I hope that you will be able to stay on for a few minutes and continue the networking, exchange emails, and get the necessary mailing list that you need to be on from the platform and other. So thank you very much for today. Thank you.
The state of our Earth can be defined by how much climate change it experiences and by the total amount of food that is available through agriculture and trade. The world has increased its agricultural production over the past centuries. At the same time, it has undergone climate change, partly as a result of activities related to agriculture. In 1850, the climate had not yet begun to change due to human activities, and food production was low. After 1950, world food production rose dramatically. Before 2000, we began to see evidence of human-induced climate change. Our climate will continue to change, given the greatly increased levels of greenhouse gases already in our atmosphere. Extreme events, such as high temperatures, droughts, and floods, are already more frequent and severe. Faced with growing demand for food, fodder, and bioenergy crops, many agriculture systems deplete soil fertility, biodiversity, and water resources. Many regions exhibit large gaps between potential and actual crop yields. The path our world takes in the future depends on the choices we make. To be sustainable in the long term, the world must stay within certain limits. This frontier curve represents the maximum amount of food we can grow under a given climate, if we do the best we can on every bit of land. It declines steeply under extreme climate change, which will have an adverse overall effect on agricultural production in the next few decades. Climate change will bring us toward, and perhaps over, critical food security thresholds in many regions. Areas currently suffering from food insecurity will be hit worst. This curve represents how much food we need to ensure everyone on Earth has adequate nutrition. The world's population will increase to around 9 billion by mid-century. It curves up under high climate change, as we will need more food to make up for greater crop losses due to climate variability and pest outbreaks. This curve represents the effect of increasing food production on climate change. As we clear more land for crops, apply more artificial fertilizer, and have larger livestock herds, the climate impact, already nearly a third of current climate change, increases. A sustainable future must be located within the space defined by these three limits. This is the safe space. Today, on a planet that grows sufficient food for all, a billion people go hungry. Another billion overconsume, increasing risks of chronic diseases. One third of all food harvested is lost or wasted. Food waste in industrialized countries is almost as high as total net food production in sub-Saharan Africa. We are not in a safe space. This is where the world is heading by mid-century, unless we make some big changes. Hundreds of millions will remain undernourished, and we will be perilously close to the limits of food production. We can take actions to enlarge the safe space and move the planet within its boundaries. First, by eliminating waste in the food chain, increasing equity in access to food, and shifting to vegetable-rich diets that demand fewer resources, we can reduce the amount of food we need. By investing in agricultural research and development, we can increase the amount of food we grow. We can also expand the safe space by adapting cropping systems to hotter climates through innovations such as improved crop genetics and careful matching of crops to environments. Ever higher average global temperatures will result in less greenhouse gas emissions are drastically reduced across a wide range of human activities. Agriculture must do its share. By carefully intensifying production on existing agricultural land, we can reduce on-site emissions and reduce deforestation. sustainable intensification will help close the food yield gap while reducing emissions per unit of food produced. By reducing greenhouse gas emissions across all sectors, not only agriculture and forestry, we can slow down the onset and potential impacts of climate change. By implementing all these actions together, it is possible for Earth to survive and prosper in the long term, even with the substantially larger human population that it will carry in 40 years' time. We must transition the world into the safe operating space through collective decisions and actions. Our most powerful actions for meeting food security needs while reducing environmental impacts include improving crop yields, reducing waste, changing diets, adapting to climate change, and reducing agricultural greenhouse gas emissions. We can achieve food security in the face of climate change. Learn about key actions for moving into the safe space and explore successful innovations from around the world.